206-667-4283 or visit ecphd.com.
Students feel they're being taken advantage of and can't afford to fight back.
I couldn't do anything. I didn't have a job. I didn't have money.
The I-Team takes a closer look at the ugly side of beauty. Thursday on News 12 at 6 o'clock.
It's a brand new year. Time to start. With Milton Rubin Toyota. Oh, yeah. Fresh inventory is arriving daily. Lease a new 2023 Camry LE for $269 a month. Milton Rubin Toyota. It's a brand new year. Time to start with Milton Rubin Chevy. Fresh inventory is arriving daily. Get 2.99% financing on a 22 or 23 Silverado 1500 Colorado, Equinox, and Traverse model. Make a fresh start today at Milton Rubin Chevy.
From the station that's on your side, News 12, first at 5, continues.
You can see here 11-year-old Justin Gilstrap making big strides in his road to recovery. And as Justin recovers, new first at 5, Columbia County says all 7 dogs have been euthanized. Police reports show 3 of those dogs attacked Justin.
And Bert Baker was the previous owner before he turned them over to Columbia County. Our Nick Veland is live outside the Children's Hospital of Georgia where Justin is recovering. And Nick, you spoke to Justin's mom today. What did she say about his recovery?
Yeah, well, when it comes to that, the surgery he was supposed to have today is now going to be scheduled for tomorrow. He's already had 5 surgeries in this process, and that's not including the one tomorrow. They've got to go back in every few days and clean things up. Justin's mom tells me he's an inspiration to her. And like you mentioned, after a week and a half, we've learned all 7 dogs Baker owned were euthanized, including the ones in the attack. And the others, the owner gave up. Justin's mom, Erica Stevens, says this isn't complete justice for her son, but it's a start. And Justin, after the attack, wanted the dogs to be put down.
And I asked him before I even told him my feelings on it, and he said that, he was like, I don't want them dogs back. So they're not coming back.
And coming up all new on News 12 at 6 o'clock, we'll hear more from Justin's mom about what Justin remembers from the night of the attack, as well as other things along with the future with his recovery.
All right, thanks for that update there, Nick. So much support outpouring from the community. We've seen it just about everywhere, those companies donating money as well to help his medical bills.
And such a tough kid, smiling through all of this.
Thumbs up.
Giving thumbs up. He's just such an inspiration, too. He's been so tough throughout all of this.
Absolutely. Turning to weather now, we got some gray skies here behind coming up in just about 10 minutes. All right, thanks, Riley. A woman in Columbia County is dead after police say she was stabbed to death by her 82-year-old husband. It happened just after noon on Gordon Highway. Robert Bennett made the call to dispatch. When police got there, they say he had already stabbed his wife, Michelle Bennett. He is facing murder and weapons charges, and no bond has been set. We are still working to learn more about a deadly accident in Burke County today. It happened on Story Mill Road near Tinker's Creek Trail, just south of Hepzibah. Due to the nature of the crash, the coroner is waiting to release more information.
Payne College has announced a new partnership that will increase STEM opportunities for students. Payne will be the leading college in medical cannabis research in the state of Georgia. The new partnership is with Botanical Science. The school will research and develop and also dispense products as it becomes available in the state of Georgia.
Well, switching gears to high school basketball, a few of our local teams brought state championships home to the CSRA last year, but so far this year hasn't been so smooth sailing for a lot of those teams.
No, not really. News 12 Sports Director Dan Booth joins us now to tell us how the reigning Class 2A state champion Westside Patriots have been able to turn it all around.
Meredith and Will, thank you, and good evening, everyone. Winning a state championship in any sport sets the bar for the next group of young athletes who have to find a way to fill the shoes of the team the previous year. In addition to having a difficult non-region schedule early on, it was not easy for Westside to discover the identity of this year's team. However, it seems the Patriots are taking the new year, new me approach into 2023 because since starting region play, Westside has been as dominant as ever, and they're getting hot at the right time.
We had a very difficult schedule at the beginning. I felt like we were built for it. We had some very good games. We took a few L's. It's okay, though, because we learned from them. You know, they're not really
losses and lessons. I was telling the guys that it's going to be like chopping wood in the winter. You know, your hands are going to be a little colder, and the temperature is going to change a little bit. But right now, we're kind of getting back to that environment of making sure we understand the importance of hard work.
The Patriots will look to keep their unbeaten region record intact on Friday night when they take on the Josie Eagles at Westside High School. Burke County has announced who will be taking over their football program. Keysville native Dr. Franklin Stevens Jr. will be the new shot caller for the Bears. He graduated from Burke County Comprehensive High School in 1991 and then went on to play college football for Georgia Southern, where he was a two-time All-American. Stevens has 16 years of head coaching experience and is the fastest coach in Georgia history to reach 100 career wins.
All right, thanks, Dan. Blight voters will soon choose a successor to the recently resigned mayor as well as a city council member. The Richmond County Board of Elections will meet Friday to consider scheduling a March 21st special election. Mayor Kurt St. Germain resigned Thursday. Councilman Edward LaJoy has also resigned. The special election would be for the unfilled portions of those terms.
One of the more frustrating things for drivers during a commute might be the slowpoke driver in the left lane who just won't get over. In South Carolina, lawmakers want to raise the fine for those slowpoke drivers. Today, the Senate Transportation Committee is debating whether to increase that fine from $25 to $100. Lawmakers first passed the slowpoke bill in 2021. Last year, state troopers wrote roughly 500 tickets. The law requires drivers in the left lane to move over if a car comes up behind them and the right lane is clear.
Well, tax evasion, money laundering, forgery, and fraud, the list goes on. Next at 5, where the attorneys detail how those crimes could have pushed Murdoch to murder his wife and son. Riley?
We are staying cloudy, and temps will be fairly warm for this time of year as we head into tonight, but we are tracking a very gusty Thursday on tap. I have a full update for you just after a quick break.
What will happen if Gold Cross decides to leave Richmond County? All new on News 12 at 6 o'clock. We're talking to Commissioner Brandon Garrett and Vice President Stephen Vincent of Gold Cross on the stakes leading into Tuesday's special call meeting, having one last shot at the Gold Cross contract.
Time and depth.
Little scratch. Checkers, 2 for $4 meets a match menu.
People ask me, what makes the iColds law firm different?
It's our commitment to serving this community.
We offer local expertise because this is our home.
You can trust us because you know us. Trust the iColds difference. Call us today.
Nothing tastes better than savings. Hardee's new 4-for-6 deal lets you mix and match your favorite flavors. That's sweet, savory, crispy, crunchy, or beefy, all for just $6. Create your favorite combinations with our new 4-for-6 deal, only at Hardee's.
Next week, disbarred attorney Alec Murdoch is set to stand trial in Colleton County, South Carolina. Prosecutors are expected to argue that Murdoch murdered his wife and son to distract from the millions of dollars he stole from friends, family, clients, and even his former law firm.
As part of our week-long coverage leading up to Murdoch's trial, Katie Kamen details those alleged financial crimes and how attorneys say the pressure from these crimes ultimately led to the murders.
Tax evasion, money laundering, forgery, fraud, and the list goes on. Ahead of the murder trial for the deaths of his wife Maggie and his son Paul, former Lowcountry attorney Alec Murdoch is also facing 19 indictments and 99 charges, all related to alleged financial crimes dating back years. And according to the South Carolina Attorney General's Office, the crimes amount to more than $8.7 million swindled from his victims.
Alex's financial crimes are nothing more than a Ponzi scheme, and all Ponzi schemes work the same way. I have to continue to steal money from new people to replace the money that I've stolen from old people. All Ponzi schemes end the same way. Sooner or later, it's like musical chairs. The music stops, and someone is without a chair. And that's exactly what happened with Alex.
But before the crimes were exposed, attorneys Ronnie Richter and Eric Bland say the list of Murdoch's financial victims was growing. It included one of their clients, the family of Gloria Satterfield, the Murdoch's former housekeeper. She died on their property in 2018 in what was once described as a trip-and-fall accident. The Satterfields were supposed to get millions of dollars from an insurance from insurance companies, Satterfield's son, and her estate, pocketing the money themselves.
As we got into the case, the 500 turns into, no, we think it might be as much as a million. It could be two, it could be three. It was $4.3 million. And of that money, the clients received not the first red dime. So it was stunning that it was that much money, and that B, the decision was made to take it all.
Beyond the Satterfield case, documents claim Murdoch defrauded hundreds of thousands of dollars from a highway patrolman injured in the line of duty, the family of a man killed in a car crash, a father of six who lost his wife in an accident, and more.
Just the amount of money involved, the exploitation of vulnerable people really has floored me and rocked me hard. You know, people that lost family members, people that needed the money for medical treatment, a lot of exploitation of minorities.
Prosecutors argue to steal the millions of dollars, Murdoch billed personal expenses to clients and on firm credit cards or accounts. He stole client money by having checks for them made out to the Palmetto State Bank, whose former CEO converted the checks for Murdoch's personal use. According to the state, Murdoch also used a fake bank account, and he stole from his own family and the firm.
He checks all the boxes on, you know, being a serial penslinger, a serial thief. He's an equal opportunity stealer. He steals from those that died, those that were injured. There's no bounds of indecency that he will not cross.
These alleged financial crimes are a key piece of the state's argument in next week's murder trial. Prosecutors argue pressure was mounting for Murdoch, his scheme unraveling, his crimes on the verge of being revealed. In fact, on the day of the murder, prosecutors say Murdoch's law office confronted him about misusing funds from the firm.
His financial crimes were going to be exposed. He said, well, if that's not enough reason to kill somebody, but maybe it is, because people do kill for money. But the prime directive is always survival and self-preservation. And so had his crimes been revealed, it doesn't just mean that he's in trouble. His lineage, his legacy, his name, the entire Murdoch dynasty crumbles.
Murdoch's defense team calls the motive illogical and implausible and claims the state has presented no evidence that establishes a clear connection between the crimes. But murder charges aside, if Murdoch were convicted of these financial crimes alone, documents show he'd be in jail for the rest of his life.
Close to 1,000 years.
Netflix is preparing to debut a new documentary on this entire saga involving former Lowcountry attorney Alec Murdoch.
And the documentary will be released on February 22nd, a month after Murdoch goes on trial for the murders of his wife, son Maggie, and Paul.
It truly is more like a movie than real life, for sure. Taking a live look at the southbound smokehouse camera over the river, a beautiful image there. Okay.
We can rain chances towards the end of the show.
All right, thank you, Riley. Imagine a day when you never say, my phone is dead. How great would that be, right? That reality is actually closer than you might think. We'll explain after the break. Thanks for watching News 12 on your side. One of the more frustrating parts of the day is when your smartphone battery dies, or when your child's smartphone battery dies and you can't get a hold of her. Well, anyway, we have to plug it in again and wait for it to recharge.
Well, there's a solution for you, maybe on the way, but those smartphones stay charged all of the time. It sounds far-fetched, but Jamie Tucker says that day is closer than we may think.
Newer smartphones have technology where you can charge a phone by placing it on a charger like this, no plugging it in. But what if you didn't even need this? Well, two companies I recently saw at CES say they can charge your phone through the air.
Is it wireless power? Just like Wi-Fi. You walk into the room in proximity of a Coda transmitter, and your devices will be powering.
I first saw Osseus 6 years ago at CES with wireless charging devices built into ceiling tiles. This year, showing these transmitters that sit anywhere in your house, they can charge phones and batteries, just about everything.
You have security cameras, motion sensors, temperature sensors, or that pesky AA battery that chirps at you in the middle of the night. If you put the code of circuitry in
company that developed a $5 chip that can be embedded in devices.
Have our transmitter devices here. They're putting RF energy into the air. And then everything on the table that's lighting up, as well as the end devices here, have our receiver chips in them. And they're pulling that RF energy out of the air and then converting it efficiently into DC power that can be used to recharge batteries.
PowerCast hopes to work with device manufacturers to include the chip in their future products. So how close are we to seeing totally wireless charging in our homes?
I think you're going to start finding this in homes at the end of this year, early next year. We are for shipping a security camera bundle. You will get a coded transmitter, and you just take that camera and stick it up on the wall, and there will be no wires. It will be constantly powered.
But is it safe having these RF waves constantly going through the air in your home? Both companies say their products are safe, and they've been certified by the FCC. That's What the Tech. I'm Jamie Tucker.
It's a brand new year. Time to start fresh with Milton Rubin Chrysler Dodge Jeep Ram. Save $8,500 off MSRP at $57,960 on a 22 Jeep Gladiator with us for $49,460. Let's start something new, salesman, at Milton Rubin Chrysler Dodge Jeep Ram.
Thinking about selling your home only at 72sold.com.
Hey, Carly, you know what I really like about our outlet store?
That it's like an amazing treasure hunt.
Yes, but...
That you can come in, get a great deal, and take it home that night.
Yes, but...
That you have this incredible array of changing styles, fabrics, designs, sizes.
Yes, what I really like is we get new items in every day, and everything is on sale.
Why didn't you just say so?
Hurry in for huge savings. Visit Weinberger's Outlet, right across the street from the main store.
In the afternoon. All right, thanks, Riley. That's all the time we have. Much more news, weather, and sports coming up after a short break on News 12.